Good evening, everyone. I hope you're having a great day. Yes?
Yes.
Ready for some excitement?
Yes.
So like Corinne said, I've been in the business for a long time. I started at Grumman, like a lot of people on Long Island, they're probably retired now. 27,000 employees, massive supply chain. Grumman recognized about 25 years ago that there was a shortage of the skill set. And through a government subsidy program, they went out to all the college grads, interviewed hundreds and hundreds of college grads every year, down selected to 12 per year, put us to school for about 12 months, paid us, and out came buyers. It's a great career, very, very innovative, creative. We need more skill set, we need more, and that's really what my focus is, trying to develop the skill sets that really are the lifeblood for corporations, which is the supply chain.
Elvis Morales, I've been with Shine for 14 years now, which means I actually have to open up a newspaper when I apply for the job. I started at the bottom, worked my way through the corporation. We're currently in over 120 different countries. We have over 330 locations globally. Last year, we imported roughly around 4,000 to 5,000 containers. Full parcel shipments, and I'm currently responsible for the import-export compliance both domestically and globally of our supply chain and our end users.
John Longaro, UPS Capital. I started my career 28 years ago. I started part-time while I was going to Hofstra University. From there, I went into something called, we used to call it customer service. I was with UPS for about 20-some-odd years. UPS bought a bank in the late 90s called Glen Lake Financial that handles all the risk mitigation and financial products for UPS. It was a good opportunity to go over there. The reason we bought the bank is to do a one-stop shop with supply chain. If you look at UPS's portfolio, we own an LTL company, an air freight company, we own a brokerage, we own the insurance piece. So the whole idea is to keep everything in the family and try to grow our business.
Yeah, over 97% of the world's purchasing takes place outside of the U.S., right? Many companies are looking to expand in the global marketplace. What are some of the risk management challenges that companies must consider before that? And John, I'll pose that question to you.
First thing, to expand globally, what lending lines are we going to use? Is the bank going to give them these lines? And do they have a risk mitigation to ensure payment of these lines? That's one of the first things that the company will do. Secondly, you have to think upstream as, can you absorb a loss if you go overseas? And what's in place to absorb that loss? And how would, and if being overseas, how are you going to collect your debt? What resources are you going to use when you're in a different country?
Okay. Anything, Ron or Elvis, you
want to
share on that?
Globally, when you're discussing how you can collect your money from a global supplier or a manufacturer, there's a lot of government agencies that are at play there. It's critical to make sure that you have banks aligned that the U.S. government is going to approve to get your money back for you. So making sure that all your I's are dotted and T's are crossed before you step forward, perhaps in your agreements or any contracts that you have for that development of the product, is critical to get done before you start moving on a purchase order.
And just really quickly, as you mentioned that, Elvis, is I was at an event for the New Reforms Institute for Sustainable Development, which is an institute that's a collaboration between SUNY and the University of the West Indies. And when you're talking about having access and being able to pay it, they're having crises where banks are not able to enter, bank relationships that are there. And that becomes very important in terms of looking at even lines of credit and what other opportunities. You talked about technology, what other means are there for them, where they're talking about the Bitcoin or the blockchain sort of technologies, right? Then APIC has a triple bottom line supply chain sustainability, right? They talk about that being a measure of sustainability that includes social and environmental and financial performances. social, environmental, and financial measures, and the whole concept of that has been around for a very long time. It's not going anywhere. It's actually heightened. Ron, can you share with us some of the how does your company implement some of these?
Well, first of all, there's an integration that takes place, right? At the end of the day, we want to be able to design product and deliver product that does not weigh on the environment, not necessarily because of an environmental constraint, but how does it translate to cost savings, right? How does it translate to higher profits, lower costs? So we really have to look at things, you know, in the past, we're looking at things from a perspective of, you know, some of the environmentalists will say, you know, we got to be able to do this to save the world and save the planet and save the... But it really comes down to, if we're going to justify it, there's got to be an ROI. There's got to be a return on investment. And while we're at it, if we could achieve sustainability, that's great. But we need to be able to have the justification for it. And then the other major aspect of this triple bottom line that Apex talks about is the people. You can't get there without the people. And that's really the skill set. And, you know, unfortunately, in our field, people are not popping out of the woodwork that has the skill that can pull from the toolbox in a given situation and be able to address and resolve and come to an adequate solution, right, that's going to ultimately present this integrated idea of the triple bottom line. So it's full integration, it's across the board, and it's the ability to think of people, the ability to understand how decisions we make impact our environment, and ultimately how those decisions in totality improve our profit by reducing our cost.
Let's talk a little bit about understanding the role for every aspect in terms of the supply chain, in terms of decision making. Do you want to share with us on that?
Sure. So every company, whether it's small or large, is going to identify key personnel of the supply chain. And moving around from company to company, you'll realize that the same responsibilities don't necessarily belong to the same departments in every company that you're at. For example, I'm in trade compliance. The trade compliance team is part of the regulatory and legal department. Most companies will have that as part of their logistics or transportation department and kind of bounce off of each other, where the position that I'm in, we kind of have to go out of our way to make sure that the communication is fluid and we know what transportation needs are and they understand what our needs from a compliance standpoint are, because we're that far removed. Also, as part of your day-to-day, it's critical to understand that once you come across a hurdle with your supply chain, who to contact. Is this a responsibility of legal? Is this a responsibility of marketing? Who acquires the compliance information of products that are created in your company? Who handles the actual technical files for, let's say, a European certification? It's critical to make sure that you know who is responsible so that you can complete your function in the company when we're discussing the risk and supply chain sustainability.
Okay. Is it set? Is it like a standardized, or is it revised?
It's a process that's reevaluated constantly. Within any organization, your supply chain is the most critical component that you can have. If you don't have a product, you don't have a company. So you're constantly reviewing the gaps. You're analyzing, do we have the right people in the right places? And maybe sometimes it's appropriate to go to outside counsel or to consultants for where a company might be lacking. UPS has been great for us. Whenever we can't handle something internally, we could just pop out to UPS and say, hey, this is our situation. Can you guide us in the right direction? And it takes these kind of events to network, get those phone numbers, where you can call somebody and just say, hey, I just need help, and that's it.
How about you, Ron?
You know, supply chain experts are supply chain experts for a reason. But what you're going to find in a lot of corporations is everybody wants to be part of the supply chain, regardless if they've been trained or they have the capability or not. So what we've been doing in our company, and the various companies that I've worked for, Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, and now Telephonics, we've been trying to make sure that the responsible, the people that are hired to do the job and been trained, are the ones that are in the front end, right? We're trying to keep the individuals that don't have that experience and the skill set out of it. Because what we find is, when you make a mistake way up here up front in the process, what happens to that problem that you create? It manifests. And when it manifests, it takes you a tremendous amount of level of effort and situation resolve to get out of it. So what we're trying to do is make sure that that front end, the front line, is protected. And keeping the people who do the job and understand the job responsible, and keeping the people that don't out of it. Because the collateral damage is miserable, and we don't want to experience it. That's my opinion.
I think when dealing with an involved company like Henry Schein, you'll see processes in place to handle that. But when you're dealing with middle market companies or small companies, they know nothing about compliance. And you know what? There's one person who might be wearing five hats, and it's just the way it is. You started selling this widget, and you just exceeded expectation on sales. So you just have to be very patient, because obviously, you know, they started this business for a reason. They're in business. So when dealing with them, just understand that, you know, like Elvis said, there are different places to go for information, consulting groups, government agencies, so on and so forth.
So just to throw a monkey wrench a little bit on one aspect of that, sure, many of them don't know, but I think some of them also, it's that it costs money and they don't necessarily, because they don't have a process or a system in place for that to be streamlined to be able to pay that. In addition, I mean, again, with this panel, or this event, they don't know where to start looking for that information, right? Is that one conventional catch? All right, so most of today, most of the manufacturing supply chain takes place outside of the US, and we're actually working on a project that we're something else that we're looking at, and it's outside, it's in Asia, it's outside of the US. Let's talk about maybe what are some of the options that are available to protect those goods and in transit. And I was thinking about, you know, a couple years ago, all this thing about the pirates and, you know, what that means to that supply chain. And then there's piracy in terms of also software system that is being used, and obviously that impact. So can you talk to us a little bit on that?
Well, you'd be surprised, but a lot of customers in the marketplace are using their carrier's general liability coverage. They'll pay for transactional insurance for the movement of goods. General liability is basically pay for, and how it works is if the shipper approves the claim, you get paid. If they deny it, you're not getting paid. So there are products in the field such as ocean marine cargo policies, which will cover complete loss, damage, or and delay, world to world, country to country, so on and so forth. That kind of policy is what any, even the smallest companies need, because not only is the cost, not only cost effective, but it's a blanket policy. The reason they used to call it a blanket policy back in the day is so you can sleep at night. Where general liability, maybe your overseas vendor doesn't declare value on the shipment. It's a $250,000 container coming from Hong Kong. It's tossed overseas. You know, you're out of luck. What do you have to make up for that $250,000 container? You know, if you do numbers, I actually have some. And I'm not a numbers guy, so this is pretty impressive. If you had a $50,000 loss with a 2% margin, you have to have sales of $2.5 million to make up for that. So, you know, if you think of industries like cell phones, electronics, where the markets are a lot lower, is that a good idea to run your business? So.
Before I'll ask if either of you want to, Elvis or Ron, want to piggyback on that. Again, similar when talking about costing, most small businesses don't get it and they don't have access. You know, they may not want to go to an accountant to be able to help them or can't afford that. But that really becomes critical, and I was going to ask you to share about the sales and looking at what that means in terms of inventory and replenishment and that sort of stuff. But it is very, very important for you to be able to understand what these risks are and what the liability is, because that will tank you sooner than anything else. And I think that's important for small businesses. But before I go to, you know, talking about sales a little bit and looking at that and in terms of inventory replenishment and so on, did either of you want to add anything to what John shared?
Yeah, just to piggyback on that, there are multiple vehicles available to back up your business from an insurance standpoint. Your surety companies can handle up to a certain value, but there's multiple policies out there. If you're in the business of manufacturing, and let's say you obtain or procure your raw materials from just a handful of manufacturers that make it available to you, it's critical to make sure that you have some kind of coverage for any kind of global issues. And regardless of anybody's political views, we're in a very politically tense global environment right now, where borders can close or open just like that. If you manufacture anything and your raw material is no longer available to you, you could be out of business overnight. There are insurance policies out there that will cover you in case there's a political issue globally, to make sure that you're covered for your losses, at least while business is down. So it definitely pays to ask the questions, have these conversations, go to outside counsel, whatever it takes. Make sure that your companies or the companies that you work for are definitely covered.
Just one note on that. You know, in my industry, the defense industry, it's the chain of custody, right? That is becoming a very, very serious topic. And it's because of what Ellis just indicated is the world we live in. It's how to get stuff gets from point A to B. And what happens to that stuff in between point A and B, right? So just my question to you guys is there insurance starting to develop from that perspective? You know, because now if you incur compromise, and I'm talking about, such as, in the event of packing something up in England in a crate, right? That crate gets closed, now you use a trucker that may not be certified, right? And now something happens from leaving the dock to getting to the airport, right?
So the biggest insurance policy you can have, and again, I'm a compliance guy, not an insurance salesman, so I'm not doing this too, but it is really investing in your compliance program for those situations. Customs has many programs that you can join with that helps solidify your supply chain from a security standpoint.
CTPAP
being the one that we don't know what kind of I don't want to say kickback in this room, sorry. I don't know what kind of return we get. What kind of return we get on the money that we drop on CTPAP, yeah. But what we can ensure is that internally you're reviewing your infrastructure, you're reviewing your supply chain, and you're forced to do it yearly. At the very least, that's worst case scenario, it should be a live program. So before you even get on the insurance policies, really close all the gaps in your system. And that could eliminate the cost of even having the insurance policy.
Yeah, ultimately you're responsible for your product.
Right.
So at the end of the day, if something gets diverted, compromised, they're gonna come back to the OEM. They're gonna come back to the OEM for penalty, and that those penalties could be quite significant and even criminal.
Yeah.
I think one thing you also have to do is when you sit down, you have a lot of larger companies have their policy under the business owner's policy. Now those policies weren't developed to cover the supply chain. They were thrown in there for the slip and fall and all the other, it's just thrown in there for catastrophic loss, right? Your deductible could be $20,000. How's that gonna help on that one shipment on that box? A good broker will sit down and go over an Ocean Marine. What we were speaking about is trade disruption. If that gets delayed, or if there's a war, if pirates, so on and so forth. And is my shipment covered once it leaves? Even though I sold it to Company A in China, they said, don't worry, don't take out insurance. Doesn't get there. What does the company in China say? If the terms are not right, well, we're not paying you. Good policies have contingent interest where you'll be covered because it's under your policy. So you sit down with the Ocean Marine cargo, and you go over your lines, and you go over what your movements are, air freight, ocean, LTL, small package, mail, and you write it out. And you know, is it time-sensitive goods? Are they perishable? These policies now are so customized that it can get to the point of, you know, a time of day when a claim will be paid. So it's just doing your homework, meeting with the right broker, one or two maybe, you know, just don't take the first person, you know, word for it, and, you know, getting a bid from them and seeing where they are. And if they know your supply chain, you know, is that what they're familiar with?
Yeah, definitely going through multiple people for that sort of information is important, because the costs that are also involved by just taking something you're searching or you're looking, and everyone can say that they can fix a problem. I find today a lot of people are saying they can't do something just because they had just a footprint for a very short time there, and they want to take that off. You really have to, I think, while we're able to multitask and do many things, you also have to be able to know that it's highly specialized times, and you have to deal with highly specialized skill sets. So let's go and talk about the sales aspect of this, and in terms of even with inventory. What we're going to talk about, reviewing sales volume, the replenishment peak inventory.
Ideally, you want to understand what your company is doing from a peak standpoint throughout the year. Understanding when your shipments are going to come in, understanding the regulations that are changing at what time of the year is really going to dictate perhaps how you're going to source these products, what resources you need to ensure compliance on these products. And just because you can get it $5 cheaper from supplier X in country A, doesn't mean that you'll be able to even get it into this country to be able to sell it. So you need to make sure that you know what the volumes are annually, so you can allocate the right resources to make sure that the supply chain is fortified throughout those peak times in the year. For a small company, it can be very simple. For a large company like Henry Schein, you know, we might just be finding out now about acquisitions that we completed in December of last year, and now we have a brand new product line coming into this country by next month. So it's critical that we have enough staff on hand to support all the intangible changes that happen in our supply chain.
So the question is with regard to sales and forecasts. Is that what you're looking at? Mm-hmm. Concentrating on? So you know, the supply chain, your suppliers are just begging for forecasts, right? Because they need to be able to ramp up and keep the pipeline full because of economies of scale, right? The last thing they want to do is be able to have a line that shuts down. Sounds easier than it is, particularly in markets that businesses and market segments that are up and down, right? Not as predictable as you want. So I think the best, and this is what we do in our company, what we do sometimes is we not only look forward, but we look backwards. I don't know if you guys do this,
yeah.
And Henry Schein, because you just can't be, you got to be bi-directional, right? Because just because you don't have an immediate forecast out on the short horizon for a particular product, in our case it's radars and communications, when I look backwards, I see, well, you know, periodically this customer, this customer, this customer wanted to buy a couple here, a couple there. They're not as predictable as you want them to be, so you need to factor that in. So I guess my only recommendation is that when we're looking at things, we should be looking forward as well as behind us, and then be able to synthesize that information to be able to come up with a projection that could mean the difference between a much higher price and a lower price, which translates back to what I originally said, which is all about profit and how we improve our profit.
Okay, so talking about profit, talk about, Ron, continue and just talk about using people in terms of lowering costs and sustainable.
Well, we got to constantly be looking at our environment, right? We got to constantly be looking at our systems. Can you guys hear me back there? Without, Will?
Yes.
It's usually pretty loud. Can't show me.
I was going to tell you to quiet down.
There you go. So you got to constantly be evaluating, assessing your environment, and looking at your value stream, right? Because we need to never become complacent. Right? We need to constantly be looking at how we do business, understand how we do business, and ultimately determine where the waste is. Because it's the waste. You know, there's an old story that I heard. It was about a company, and a guy was in his office, and every month he used to go and he used to run up to the video to the copy machine on the second floor and make 500 copies of this one document. They used to take it, he used to put it in the inner office mail, and he used to push it out to about 10 mailing stations. Turned out, guess how many people actually read that document? No. And then when he was asked, why do you do that every month? Why do you go up to the second floor, you take about an hour and a half out of your day, you're making all these copies, you distribute it, and nobody's doing anything? Well, he said, it's the way we always did it. Well, that's where you get in trouble. We can't do things. We can't, you know, one of the classes I teach is problem solving. And one of my heroes is Einstein, right? Because one of his favorite sayings, one of his most famous quotes, is we can't solve today's problems at the same level of thinking we were when we created them. So we always have to be in that mode. And that's how we drive costs down. You have to be searching for ways to drive costs down. And you never should stop. And none of the people that work for you should ever stop. Because ultimately, it's going to be their point and our point of survival and sustainability.
And even with small businesses, that's a challenge that a lot of small businesses face, is they stick with what works. Like, this work, we're not going to change it, and the cost to change it. And again, if they're able to source that valid information that's going to help them to streamline, you know, now it's everything is technology. If you're not, you don't have the mobile apps and the mobile, anything that's user-friendly that's going to help to get to your customer sooner, and not have the disruption, it's definitely very important. Do either of you
want to
add to?
On a risk mitigation end, you have companies in the retail, especially fashion. Everyone factors. That's the way my father did it, and these are companies that have been around 100 years. They all factor. The percentage is, let's say, 2 to 4%. They do their accounts receivable. There are tools out there that can give you the money you need and give you the protection you need at, like, half a basis point. You'll speak to these companies in New York City, and these are some large fashion houses, and they'll say, again, to your point, this is the way we've always done it. This is my cousin, this is my friend, this is my neighbor. But that, if you don't forward think, all that money you're wasting, friend, relative, whatever it is, you have to think, if there's a new tool out there in the market that works better, that can work better, you have to be open-minded. Because if you're not open-minded, that 100-year-old company is not going to be around for 120, 130, so on and so forth.
Yeah, they go out pretty quickly, and that's kind of what happens even when they have the second or third generation that comes in. They inherit, they don't change, and they wonder why they're not doing business anymore. Do you want to share something?
Yeah, from a quality standpoint, and I know we're on the risk side, but when you're looking at risk, you're also looking at quality and the cost of quality to add to your supply chain. Products that you're sending back that aren't in conformance, whatever it is, that all adds up to your landed cost at the end of the day. And Six Sigma basically says that waste is described as anything you'd be ashamed to tell your customer they're paying for. And at the end of the day, that's what it comes down to. When you break down your supply chain and your product line, if you calculate every person, everybody that touches that product to add to your landed cost, if you'd be ashamed to turn to your customers and say, listen, we just paid Mr. Smith $80,000 a year to do this one thing that means absolutely nothing to you. Would you be okay with that? And at the end of the day, they probably wouldn't be. So anytime that you can remove a waste like that, definitely adds to your product, adds to your sales, adds to your credibility.
I got good news. We're all taxpayers, right? Think so. I deal very often with the government, right? And the agency that we work with is called DCAA. That's Defense Contracting Auditing Agency. And every dollar we spend, every penny we spend, it's getting probably even more aggressive, is thoroughly evaluated, right? Thoroughly evaluated. There's one thing that's really important. So all these companies have indirects, right? We all have indirect rates. One of the things that gets removed, and what's an indirect rate? An indirect rate is your cost of the overhead cost of doing business, and the job of a good CEO and a good CFO is to drive those indirect rates down, right? Because now your product becomes cheaper because that's incorporated into your cost model. Well, when you do really bad in business and you drive it, and for some reason you had a screw up, you had a bunch of rejects, you had a retrofit program, those costs associated with that are not allowable. They have to come out of your indirects, because what's happening is when your indirects go up because of problems that and inefficiencies within your organization, now somebody's paying more for that product. And the government says, I'm not paying for your screw ups. So you figure out another way to lose money. So that's the good news for today. Because I live it every day. And it's good. It really is good. Because as a taxpayer, I like to see that. So do better.
And as a consumer.
Yeah. Do better. And then you don't have to pay a bill.
All right, I'll try.
Except for you here.
So the weather has been really nice, even though it's changed a little bit, right? Yeah, it's starting to get cold. The golf season, PGAs, right? Mm-hmm. So talking about PGAs, partnered government agency, tell us about some of the things that the new products that they regulate and some of the processes about, you know, what you have to go through with the FDAs and so on.
Right. So, again, I work for Henry Schein, and I deal with mostly medical devices. When we're sourcing something that's incredibly simple, for example, gloves, the examination gloves, that comes from Malaysia or Brazil. Those products are regulated by the FDA. So a pre-market approval has to be provided by the FDA. You have to have registration facilities. You have to have SOPs in place. You have to have complaint procedures in place. You have to have everything under the sun to make sure that you can bring that product here and market it to the U.S. consumers. That's what you do if you try to create a sustainable supply chain. There are other suppliers out there, smaller mom-and-pop online companies that are just going to source products and try to get them into the end user's hands. All your PGAs, which are the partner government agencies, are going to dictate how hard you're going to work to get that product into the country. Recently, we've had an update at the ports, a software called ACE, that incorporates your customs entries with all your partner government agencies' information. In my case, it's FDA. So once we submit an entry to customs, they're going to send it over to the FDA. FDA is going to take a look at it and see if we have provided, or our brokers have provided, all the affirmations of compliance required to assure or to provide the attestation that these products have met the level of conformity of the FDA previously. If you haven't done all that homework before you've placed that PO, it's going to get here and it's going to sit and it's going to cost you money. And if you by chance actually get it released and put it into your distribution network, you've lost every single dollar that you made on it by the time it gets there. So again, speaking to UPS, having them help you understand what the cost of doing business for that commodity is, absolutely critical. Get out there, speak to people. For the college students in the room, this is great, because I know most of us that do compliance, logistics, risk management, we didn't go to school and say, this is what we're going to do with our lives. At some point, we fell into this. We started working for a company where there was a need, and we fulfilled that need somehow. So understanding that the world is bigger than New York State and bigger than Long Island, primarily, and all of our products come from outside of the U.S., I think you said 97%? That's a big number. There's a massive need to make sure that we can move these products fluidly in and out of this country. And you know, I've been in the business for 14 years. I'm 33 years old. I don't know if retirement's gonna get me or a heart attack's gonna get me first, but most of us are gonna start moving our way out. And it's a critical time for students to step up and say, hey, can you spend some time with us? Help us understand these things. the country is literally depending on college students today to keep the borders open. So it's more critical than ever that we have these conversations.
All right, so just a quick FYI, it's 97% of the purchasing happens.
Purchasing, that's
yeah.
In the country.
Yeah. So then let's jump a little bit and talk about, go back, John, to like talk about the risk management solution and what's out there to help small businesses, help to grow businesses.
Well, there's a bunch of tools available. The one I get excited about is what's called trade credit insurance. Years ago, it was called accounts receivable insurance. It started in Europe in the 1900s. And how it works, if you think about it, if you have bad debt and the customer doesn't pay you, it goes in the same lines of cargo insurance. How many sales do you need to make up to cover for that bad debt? What trade credit insurance allows you to do, it allows you to utilize a tool where it's insurance. If your customer doesn't pay you, you'll get paid on the policy. So how does that help my business grow? Well, currently I offer terms, I'm a medium-sized business, and my average terms are $10,000. Because that's all I'm willing to risk, because you know I can't risk anymore, I don't trust anyone, right? Because I don't have the infrastructure to handle that. Trade credit insurance will allow, now if you could double that to every customer, say, you know what, from now on, I'll offer you $20,000 up front, because we're already set. Now you're doubling your sales. In return, it pays off. It pays for the policy. Usually, like I was saying before, it's about a quarter basis point to get a policy such as this. Now, how would you grow sales internationally? That's the first thing you see. Customers, you'll go into big customers, medium size. We don't go overseas. We've been burnt before. We don't. You know, we can't get payment. We don't want to deal with lines of credit. We don't want to deal with the time it takes to get lines of credits. Your customer in Brazil wants to order, you know, $500,000 worth of product. The ropes that some customers turn away, and they'll just go to another company, because that company has something in line with trade credit insurance. They, I can offer you that. You know, I know I'm insured. I know I'm going to get payment, and if I have to, I know I can recoup it because I can. I have a collection arm on that. There's other things, you know, going internationally. You know, nowadays there's, you know, everyone's taking credit cards. You know, people, the day of the COD is going away with the credit cards. Can you take a credit card internationally? No one really wants to do that either because of the fraud that goes with it. There are tools in place that have, you know, credit card fraud protection, 3D check up front, insured. If you don't get paid, they pay you. And usually that works on based on the number of shipments that you do per month with that vendor.
Do you have anything to add to that, Ron,
with
the
vendor
side in terms of solutions?
Sure, stay within the U.S. quite honestly, that's a lot of my job is risk mitigation. A lot of the standards are changing. ISO 9000, right? You guys familiar with it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right? Picked it up in your classes? 9001, right? Well, it was really, before 2015 release, it was really based on making sure that you have processes and procedures in place, right? Once the 2015 release came out, it's really focusing on front-end risk-based, right? Decisions are based on risk assessment. And now it's your job to find where those risks are and then implement mitigation actions in order to not rely upon processes and procedures as much in order to run your business, right? Because the theory is, and it does work, that if you stop all the risks, or as many as you can, from even getting in the door, then you won't need all those processes and procedures down the line that were put in place to deal with the problems that those risks developed, created. I'm not going to say the quote again. It's Cree. Can't solve today's problems at the same level that you were yesterday. So I did say it. But it is front-end risk assessment. Now, there is other tools that we use. Now, I'm not sure if Shine or UPS, there's a risk management tool called Dun & Bradstreet. What's management? The Dun & Bradstreet Risk Management System is new, and it's looking at my entire supply chain and it's given me indicators of environmental impact, liens that were financial situations, organizational changes. And they're really getting it through data mining now. That's really what they're doing. They're really getting all this information. And it doesn't tell me that the sky has fallen down on a supplier, but it gives me an alert. And it tells me something that I should have either myself or my staff look into. So we have to spend more time at the front end. Sure, there's going to be deals that you might lose, right? You got to make those decisions, and sometimes the insurance obviously is going to give you a little bit more comfort that if the deal fell through, you're going to be able to cover. However, the real theory is not to ever get into those deals to begin with.
I think the
right, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, just to elaborate, Dun & Bradstreet and Moody's are like the two big companies.
Yeah.
Any kind of trade credit insurance company uses them, their base, as well as their own infrastructure. Certain companies have, you know, locations over 230 countries around the world, and they build these large, there's three major players. There's Ullermes, Coface, and a company called Atreides. They build these large databases. So if you have a credit insurance policy and I'm covering you, I guarantee he's being covered by someone else. So when they go look at you, they say, I want credit on him. And they say, you know what? He's already a policy holder. So you are looking at how the economy's doing. But with these policies, they give you monthly updates, weekly. There's things called credit intelligence. So before I step out and do business with Henry Schein, I'm going to look how they're rated. They rate customers one through